What's happening, y'all? Welcome back. This video is an extension to a previous video where we talked about the entry by entry definition of a matrix. In this video, we're going to see other ways to define a matrix. Specifically, we're going to focus on the row partition definition of a matrix, the column partition definition of a matrix, and also a more general concept of block matrices. Let's jump right in by reviewing the entry by entry definition of a matrix. Here it is. We start with the number of rows M and the number of columns N. We say that an M by N matrix A is a rectangular array of real numbers where A is given by this matrix form structured in rows and columns. When we define a matrix using the entry by entry definition, we have to physically write out each entry of the matrix. Here, each entry has three identifying features. One of them is the row index, the second is the column index, and the third is the value stored at that address. The entry by entry definition requires that we identify each and every value that we want to store and put it in the appropriate location to do so. This definition is super useful when we want to think about A in terms of its individual elements, but there are many applications in linear algebra and in matrix analysis when instead of thinking about the individual elements, we want to break A into larger chunks. In other words, we want to partition A into organizational structures that are larger than just the single element. That's exactly what we're going to do in this video. We'll start by looking at something called the row partition of A. The difference between the entry by entry definition and the row partition definition is that in the row partition, instead of specifying the matrix A using individual entries, we say that we define the matrix A based on a collection of predefined row vectors. In other words, to define an M by N matrix, suppose that we already have a list of M different row vectors, each one having one row and N columns. We can actually define the matrix A by just stacking those row vectors one on top of the other. So we say that the row partition definition of a matrix is given by row 1, row 2, all the way down to row M, where each of these rows have identical dimensions defined by one row and N columns. Notice we actually have to define each of those rows entry by entry. But once we've done so, we think about A as organized by rows rather than individual entries. We'll see that this is especially useful when we start talking about matrix vector multiplication and matrix matrix multiplication. This can also be useful for defining matrices in applied problems. Let's look at how to define a matrix using its row partition in MATLAB syntax. Over here, we see that this follows the same pattern as any variable declaration. On the left-hand side, we have our variable name, any matrix name we choose to use. In this class, we're talking about using a single uppercase letter for matrices. Then we write the assignment operator. On the right-hand side of the assignment operator, we use the left brace and the right brace to indicate that this is going to be a matrix. Then, instead of writing the individual entries of our matrix, we're actually going to place inside a list of predefined row vectors. So, assuming that we've already saved the first row vector in memory, the second row vector, the third row vector, all the way to the last desired row vector in our matrix, and that all of these row vectors have the same dimension, we can literally define the matrix by referring back to those previous row vectors. At the end of each row vector, we use a semicolon to indicate to MATLAB, this vector ends here and should constitute an entire row. Please start the next row with the next row vector. Let's take a look at an example where we've stored 4 1x5 row vectors. We'll say that row 1 is the row vector that starts at 1, goes to 5, increments by 1. Row 2 is the row vector that starts at 5, goes down to 1, decrements by negative 1. Row 3 is going to be starting at negative 5, going up to negative 1, incrementing by 1. And row 4 is going to start at negative 1, go down to negative 5, and increment by negative 1. Now, instead of having to define the individual entries of my matrix A, I can now use the row partition by just telling MATLAB, let the first row vector R1 sit in the first row of this matrix. Once I slap a semicolon inside there, MATLAB understands, end the first row where you see the semicolon and start the next row right after that, where I'm gonna drop R2 in. Next, I'm gonna drop R3 in. And then for the final row, I'm gonna put R4. This is now a row partition definition of my matrix A because I am not specifying the individual entries. Instead, I am stacking a 1x5 vector on the top. Right under that, I concatenate or append or just put inside another 1x5 vector. Right below that, in the third row, I put a 1x5 vector. And I end with a 1x5 vector. When I define this matrix, notice it is exactly what I expected. Each individual row was defined as a vector, not through its individual entries. Of course, it is true that I actually have to define the individual entries somewhere in memory. It would not have worked had I not done that. But the point of the matter is, when I am defining A, I am thinking in a larger structure than entry by entry. In this case, I'm grouping it all by rows. In addition to having a row partition definition of a matrix, where we're defining the matrix row by row in the aggregate, we also have what is known as a column partition definition of a matrix, where we define the matrix that we want given column by column. In order to do so, let's assume that we've defined n different column vectors, A1, A2, all the way down to An, each of which have m rows and one column. In order to define our matrix A using a column partition, we simply stack these columns left to right, right next to each other, and say A is equal to the matrix formed by putting the first column A1 to the left of the second column A2, and we continue in this fashion until we get to the last column An. Recognize that each of these have m rows and one columns. The moment that I put A1 right next to A2, now I have an m by 1 next to an m by 1, so those two columns together form an m by 2. Then I put A3 to the right of A2, now I have an m by 3, and I keep going all the way until I get to the last column, which leaves me with an m by n matrix. Once again, we are not referring to A using its most refined version, which is entry by entry. Instead, we're thinking about A as a collection of column vectors. Let's take a look at the syntax to define a matrix using its column partition in MATLAB. Follows the exact same pattern that we've seen before. We have the variable name on the left-hand side of the assignment operator or equal sign. On the right-hand side, we delimit the outside of the matrix with the square brackets. And then inside the square brackets, we're going to individually place predefined column vectors, column 1, column 2, all the way through the last column. We're going to separate the two column vectors by a comma. Remember, the comma was the delimiter to tell MATLAB, take the element on the left-hand side and think about this as a separate column in the element in the right-hand side. In this case, each of the column vectors should have the same dimension, and we're telling MATLAB, here is my first column vector, end that column, and then append my second column vector, comma, end that column, and keep doing this until I get down to the last column vector. Let's take a look at studying how to define a matrix using the column partition, thinking about a real-world example. Suppose we're going to study dropping a ball from a particular height and filming that in a digital camera over 1 second. So in this situation, we're going to create a time vector that starts at 0, goes up by 1 divided by 30 seconds, all the way to 1 second. So this digital camera is going to be filmed at 30 hertz or 30 frames a second. Notice this inside vector is a row vector. We delimit the outside with the square braces and then put a little transpose operator. So T is now a 1x31 vector. Indeed, if I looked at T, it would be starting at the zeroth time, going all the way down to 1 second using increments of 1/30 seconds, or in other words, 30 frames per second. Then we're going to define three vectors. One of them is going to be T each element raised to the zero power. Remember that any element to the zero power is 1. The second vector that we're going to define is take each element of t and raise it to the first power. And then the third element we're going to find is take each element of t and raise it to the second power. I notice that I have a little mistake here. I'm going to go ahead and clear the ae variable, and instead I'm going to define a3 as t, take each element of that and raise it to the second power. Now when I define my matrix A, I'm going to go ahead and do that by columns. The first column is going to be A1. I put a comma to say that is the end of the first column. Then I put A2. I put a comma to say that's the end of the second column. Then I put A3, and that tells MATLAB this matrix has three columns. When I push enter on this, notice that I have A defined by column 1, which is t to the 0th power, each element. Column 2, which is to take each element of t and raise it to the first power. And then column 3, which is to take each element of t and raise it to the second power. This is actually a famous matrix known as the Vandermonde matrix. It's used in least squares modeling. We'll see that later on in this course and also in introductory linear algebra. The point of this, though, is notice this definition allows me to do a lot of entry by entry work without having to specify the entries. Imagine if I had to type out every single one of these elements in MATLAB. Imagine how long that would have taken me to define the matrix A. Instead, by grouping them into columns, I get to save a lot of that space. Both the row partition and column partition definitions of a matrix are actually examples of a larger structure in linear algebra, which is known as a block matrix or a block partitioned matrix. In this video, we're going to focus on the least complex version of that, which is just defining a larger matrix from four subblocks. Specifically, suppose that we have a matrix A that has P rows and Q columns. Say that we have a matrix B that has the same number of rows as A, P rows, but maybe different number of columns, call it R. And then a matrix C that has the same number of columns of A. Here A has Q columns. In this case, C would also have Q columns, but maybe a different number of rows. So in this case, let's say that C had S rows. And then we'll say that the matrix D has the same number of columns of B and the same number of rows of C. In other words, it has S rows and R columns. We can define a larger block matrix by simply stacking each of these matrices next to each other or on top of each other. So here, this larger matrix has the property that A has P rows, B also has P rows, A has Q columns, B has R columns. So here we have Q columns plus another R columns. Here we have P rows plus another S rows. So this is a P plus S times Q plus R matrix. That is known as a block matrix, and notice that the column and row dimensions of this must align appropriately. Let's take a look at an example that comes from a real-world engineering modeling problem and results in a block partition definition of a matrix. We're going to return to the idea of using matrix analysis on electrical circuits often in this course. The bottom here, we see a schematic or a diagram that represents a circuit that has 7 resistors, 3 voltage sources, and 3 current sources. Here's a claim. The matrices in the command window here, AR0, AV0, and AI0, those are very much connected with the connectivity of this circuit. We can store each of those in MATLAB's memory, which I've already done here on screen. Notice AI0, AR0, and AV0 all sit in memory. This matrix G is associated with the resistance of the corresponding resistors, or another way to say that is the conductance. Don't worry about any of this. And then the matrix C has to do with the appropriate block partition matrix that arises when turning this circuit analysis problem into a matrix equation problem. This block matrix equation that arises comes from something called the modified nodal analysis algorithm. The point, though, is we're going to focus on the block matrix done here. We have not yet learned what matrix multiplication is, so we're not going to be able to understand all of the operations inside. What I want to show you, though, is once I have these matrices in memory, defining this matrix here is as easy as the following call. First, I define the block in the 1-1 entry. So in order to do this, I'm going to use a matrix multiplication. Here I have the transpose of the AR0 matrix multiplied by the conductance matrix, which stores the reciprocals of the resistances. And then I multiply that by just AR naught, the resistance incidence matrix. Over here, I have AV naught transpose. That's the transpose of this matrix. Then I put a semicolon, which says that ends row one of this matrix. In the start of row two, please just drop AV naught. So that means end the columns defined by AV naught, and then put Z at the end. Notice when I define this matrix, I actually get a very large structure out. Imagine if I had to type in each of those individual elements using the entry by entry definition, that would have taken a lot of work. The point of the block partition definition, it allows me to accomplish the same outcome, but to do so in subsequent steps. This is super useful for algorithmic processing of matrices, and we'll see that this comes into practice quite often in this class when we're using modeling techniques to define matrices over many steps. With that, we now have four different mechanisms for defining matrices: entry by entry, row by row, or row partitioned, column by column, column partitioned, and then also block matrices, where we're defining the larger structure by focusing on sub-blocks of those matrices. That leads us into the community challenge of today. In the comment section below, please link to posts or ideas about other places in real-world modeling that block matrices arise. For example, if I was answering that problem, I might point to a recent paper by two scholars. One of them is Stephen Ramon Garcia, and the other one is Roger Horn. They wrote a paper in a journal called Primus, Problems, Resources, and Issues in Mathematics Undergraduate Studies, called Block Matrices in Linear Algebra. You can actually get a copy of that, not on this website, but through Stephen Ramon Garcia's personal website. He works at Pomona College. If you were to type in Pomona College Stephen Garcia, you'd get to this, and then you can go to his personal website. Notice if you go over to publications and then go down until you see block matrices, here I think it's about number 21 down on the list. You can click on that link and it will automatically download a paper that introduces many places that block matrices show up in linear algebra. Here was an example of something that we saw: column 1, column 2, column 3. Here's another example using eigenvalue theory: column 1, column 2, all the way to column k. This paper shows some theoretical approaches. The challenge to you viewers is to see if you can find similar resources that highlight application-based modeling techniques that take advantage of block matrix structure. Thank you so much for your attention. I always welcome your questions and comments. I'll see you in the next one.